By the end of this video, you'll understand all the fundamentals of the array modifier and see just how powerful it is on its own. What's up? I'm Jonathan and welcome to Maker Tales, where I'm sharing my maker journey to help you go further in yours. So don't forget to subscribe and hit that little bell icon to never miss an opportunity to keep making. This video is all about the array modifier and just how powerful it is all on its own. I am having to do just on its own as it's such a powerful modifier with other modifiers that I want to show you just the modifier itself and then how it does with other modifiers later on. Starting from a fresh Blender file, let's invert our selection, delete our camera and light because we're about to explore the array modifier. Now, before I jump into this, I need to say that I am going to be splitting this up into two videos. One is very much just the array modifier in itself, what it does, and everything about it. The next video will be things very similar to the array modifier, as well as advanced use cases of the array modifier, because the array modifier is a behemoth. It works so great with other modifiers. So let's go ahead and let's get started with this. Remember that if you haven't followed me on the other modifiers, I really suggest that you do at least the other modifiers, if not the entire course, because I really have gone into a lot of detail. So let's go ahead and let's apply this array. Now, if you don't know what an array is, let's make this a little bit more visually sort of clear what's going on. So let's go ahead, let's put on our wireframe so we can see the wireframe, and let's take a look at the modifier itself. So right this minute, we have a fit type of fixed count of 2. Let's ignore this offset for now, but so 1, 2, there we go. We have 2 cubes here. One is the original, the other one is this copy. Keep this in mind though. They are a copy, they aren't mesh. So you can't go ahead and edit it, but you can edit the root object, which edits itself. So this is, so to speak, an instance of the array. Okay, so that's that. Now let's talk about this whole relative offset thing. We will go into the fit type a little bit later. So this relative offset right this minute is set to 1. So why is this here? What's exactly going on? Well, the relative offset is based off the bounding box. We learned this over in the Boolean modifier, exactly what it means, but basically it's a box that can fit around your mesh as close as possible. So that would mean that if we set this to 2, you would have the space in between these two right now to have another one of those meshes. And just to illustrate this a little bit more visually, let's just move this on the X, and you can see that there is enough space now to fit that there. However, if we were to move this on the Y, and by the way, this here is how you can do diagonal arrays. So if we increase the count, you'll see it. There we go, a diagonal array. And so just on the Y, you can see that the bounding box is just as wide as the cube itself. All right, let's undo that. I hope that explained the relative offset. Now let's talk about the constant offset. One thing to keep in mind while we're going over there is that you can have two of them on at the same time. I haven't really used this that much, but I have seen some people create some great things using multiple offsets on arrays. All right, so what is this constant offset? Well, the best way that I like to look at it is basically think of it as you're duplicating it, so doing a Shift D and then moving it along. So if we drop down here, you can see we're moving along 1 millimeter, and that's exactly the result we would get here. So as you can imagine, if we move this by 3 and our cube is 2 millimeters, you can see that up at the top, we have 1 millimeter gap between these two. All right. I think that's pretty clear on how that works. And you can obviously set this on the Y and the Z however you're wanting. Right. So let's go ahead and let's increase our count to 5 for now. I want to skip over this object offset right now because it's going to be way too complicated to go straight into that because we'll spend the rest of the video on there. So let's talk about the merge and the caps. I'm not going to talk about UVs because we don't really use them in precision modeling. So this constant offset, let's set this to 2 so they're touching right next to each other, and we now already know what a merge would do. That's basically gone ahead and merged all of our meshes together here. Because right this minute, this isn't real mesh, but when you go ahead and apply it, it would go ahead and merge all of these together. All right, so we understand that from many other ones. And now we have this here, caps. What exactly is a cap? Well, I'm pretty sure you can gather what a cap is, but if we create some mesh, you will understand a little caveat to keep in mind here. So we're going to move that there, do a Shift D, and we're going to do a strange edit to this one and apply the scale of it. So, right here, first things first, before I put in any cap, I want you to see that if we go ahead into up here and we go to our tools and our origin point, we can move our origin point wherever we want. It doesn't matter because the array is doing it off the mesh itself, not the origin point. Now let's do the same with caps once we show what that is. So the start cap, another little caveat, is it's before the beginning and this is after the end for the end cap. It doesn't go ahead and put the first one right at the beginning and right at the end. These are like additional ones and they will use the origin point for this. And if we go ahead and move the origin point now, you will see how it affects the end and start. Okay, so with that covered, let's go into the more complicated things now. So to get more complicated, let's start on the easier side of things. I'm just going to undo here and delete these here. Let's just quickly cover the fit type. Fit type isn't that complicated, but it can be a little bit weird. So fit type, we have fit length and curve. I think they're pretty self-explanatory here. So first one, fit length. Right this minute, we have this set to 3 millimeters. The length is 0. So if we set this to 30, we should basically get 10 of these. Let's take a look. We have 11 along here because basically it's taking it from the relativity of the middle of the bounding box. So it has just that little bit extra to be able to make 11. But as you can see, depending on the length is depending how many copies it's going to make along that length type. Now you might have got quite excited seeing this little fit length saying fit curve. Now it is quite interesting, this fit curve. So let's go ahead and let's create a Bezier curve. So we've got this Bezier curve. I'm going to scale this up a bit. I'm going to apply the scale. I'm going to move this over this way a little bit, and then let's go ahead and tell our array to be that Bezier curve. And let's take a look at this on the top. So as you can see, on the length of this curve, it has gone ahead and arrayed. Now if we go ahead and edit this curve, you can see that it will be less and more. Keep in mind that it does take into consideration the total of the curve. So as you can see, as we stretch this curve out, it gets longer because technically that's what's happening. So it's the curve, full length of the curve, what's happening here. Now you might be saying, okay, but I want to array along that curve. That's going to come in the next video. We need to understand the full modifier first. Okay, so we've got that there. We understand the length and we understand the curve. Now let's go ahead and let's talk about this object offset. So the object offset is very similar to two other ones that we've already done, which is the mirror modifier and the screw modifier. So you'll see a lot of similarities soon. So we're going to just move this out. We're going to put our 3D cursor over on the world origin here, and let's go ahead and create ourselves a null. Because as we know, this object is going to need something that's going to need an origin point, because that's usually what's going to happen when we're talking about other objects. So let's click this object offset onto our empty. Let's turn off this constant offset because we don't want a double one. So let's turn on this object offset and you'll see what happens right now. Boom, we now have 5 copies along the distance of the offset of this origin point to that origin point. Yes, you heard that right. Origin points are now important. So if we move just the origin of this, you can see that it's the relationship between the origin point and this other object that controls this. Now let's go ahead and explore that a little bit further. So that means that our other object here, our empty, if this empty goes about and, I don't know, starts to rotate, what would happen? Oh, that means that it's going ahead and every single time it does an array, it's rotating that amount. It also applies to scale and position. So let's go and put that rotation on once again. Then let's go ahead and scale this. And then let's also do a little, I don't know, GZ upwards. And as you can see, we're starting to get this step up effect. Now, if you can truly understand the origin and object relationship with the array modifier, this is how we go ahead and do radial arrays. Now, how would we go about doing that? Well, we need to go ahead and say your origin point of this is where the origin point of your controlling object is. So let's go ahead and do that. All we're going to do is right click, set the origin point to the 3D cursor, because the 3D cursor is at the 0, 0. So with that done, we now should understand that the distance of where this is in relationship to this point here is the radius of our radial array. I hope that makes sense. Let's go ahead, let's move our origin object here of this origin offset, and you'll see as we turn it, it creates this radial effect. Now, there is a mathematical way of figuring out the perfect amount, and Blender makes this quite easy, because remember, Blender inputs are mathematical inputs as well. So we can go right here to our rotation amount, and let's just go ahead. We have 5 here, so 360 degrees divided by 5, and there we go, the perfect amount needed. So let's go ahead, let's make this a little bit more complicated. Let's go and set this to 12, and let's go and do a nice 360 divided by 12. And now we have this sort of like clock hand, you could imagine. So there we go, that's a nice radial array, and the distance set here is basically the diameter or the radius, whatever you're wanting to deal with. Perfect. Let's go ahead and move this. Oh dear, what's happening here? It's all going crazy and not what I want. Yes, we are now bound by our origins. You have to move these both collectively, and when you rotate them and do strange things with them, they have to be done collectively as well. So how can we do this in such a way that we can then connect this all together to one operator? We're coming now to a realm of something called rigging within Blender, but this is, I wouldn't even consider this really rigging, but it technically is. So we're going to create another null here, a single arrow, and we're going to go ahead and make this nice and big. And this is very similar to the screw modifier in the sense that we're going to select both of these and we're going to parent them to this. Now, before I do that, you might say, well, why don't you just parent the cube to that and you'll be fine, right? Okay, well, let's do that. I'm going to parent it to our original null there. So it's got nothing to do with that arrow there. And yeah, it works. Okay, great. Moving it, rotating it. Okay, but you know what? I'm really wanting to change what's happening here. So let's change the segments. And now, okay, I'm wanting to go back to my 5. And now I'm wanting to rotate just this. So that would be rotating. Oh, wait, what's... There's your problem. You can no longer set the rotation in an easy way. It can still be done. So how do we go about and fix this? Well, we tell both of these objects to be the child of this parent. So we select the children and bring it to the parent, and then we parent it. And now we will still have our rotation. We can still go ahead and move this however we want. And then we can select this big arrow that we've created. And this controls the whole radial array however we want. We can go ahead and rotate it. We could even go ahead and scale it if we want. You can do absolutely everything using that. Now, something else we can go ahead and do now that we have this whole thing. It doesn't need this. You could have done it beforehand. But we can go ahead and move this and start to create a whole bunch of crazy things with this. As you can see, we can scale this in, start getting really creative. I don't know how this really goes with precision modeling, but you can get some pretty crazy results very quickly with arrays and understanding how they all work collectively. Well done for getting through the fundamentals of the array modifier. As you can see, it is an extremely powerful modifier all on its own. And just you wait and see, when you start adding other modifiers to it, it explodes in functionality. A huge thank you to my patrons. You guys are absolutely awesome, and it's the reason why I'm able to create all these videos here completely for free. And if you're enjoying what I'm making here and you think I'm worthy of your support, I would love to see you there too. Don't forget that we have a Discord, and that's linked down in the description. Thank you for watching, keep making, and let the quest continue.